Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Rajiv Gerela, Vice President, GT Production End User Services, Deutsche Bank. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir. May we now call upon Ms. Shruti Chawla, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, to introduce Mr. Rajiv Gerela.
A very good morning to one and all present. I have the privilege of introducing our guest speaker for this session, Mr. Rajiv Gerela. Mr. Rajiv Gerela is Vice President with Deutsche Bank. Rajiv sir is Head of End User Central Operations and Global Command Center along with Service Availability Management. Rajiv sir's area of expertise include infrastructure management, process optimization, managing large distributed teams and vendor management. Rajiv sir is an alumni of Shivaji University and Jai Hind College. Sir, now I request you to please enlighten us with your words of wisdom. The dais is all yours, sir.
Good morning. Morning, sir. Great to hear that loud morning. So I know everybody's awake at least. You can hear me clearly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Taking on some of the things I think you heard the first speaker, my counterpart Rajiv again, I think some of the things that he spoke about, did you all find it resonating with what you're doing? Yes. Made sense? Or was it in the air? Made sense? Okay. Some of the things that he spoke about in terms of personal skills, I think that's very relevant because when you talk of skills, that's what we are speaking of, the future skills. I think those are very critical, and even Veluri sir spoke about some of them, which was very important. How do you personally conduct yourself? How do you take yourself on a day-to-day basis? I think those are very important things. One of the things that Rajiv Mitra said, and which I don't agree, and that's why I'm trying to bring it here, and I'll elaborate a little bit before I get into my presentation. He said you should not be opposing things. I tend to disagree. Why? Any thoughts? Absolutely. Not challenging is not the right thing. Any thoughts? Absolutely. Absolutely. So what he meant was you should not be following blindly, or you should not be opposing too much. In a team, when you work in corporates, you are large number of teams. So you have to sometimes go with the team, sometimes still put across your point. How do you diplomatically put across that point is where the skill lies. And to elaborate, I'll also share with you what I look out for when I'm hiring somebody like you. Okay? So what are the things that when I interview somebody like you, do I look for? How many of you think academics plays what kind of a role? Below 50%? Very good. So, below 20%? I rated at 10%. Why? Academics is important. You are passing and failing is a line on that paper. You are proud, I am also proud that you have passed. Yes, a failure may add a problem to it. But why I say 10% only probably is what are the other dynamics that come across? What have you done as an individual? Whether it's a project, whether it's a learning, whether it's a self-taught learning, whether it's an external learning. All those matter more. Tomorrow when you come into my organization, how will you react with my team? Will you be a team player? Will you be a team destroyer? Or a team damager? That's more critical. As a project happens, how do you participate and contribute to that project? Taking my earlier point, are you opposing to make a point, or are you opposing to destroy the project? Makes a big important thing. Another important thing that I like to talk about. Are you a person who has some kind of extracurricular activity? Sports, reading, learning, team exercises, anything. Just academics is not going to help you. Be very clear about that. You have to go beyond. And why I'm saying it, sports? Because personally, when you do sports or when you do any activity outside, one, it relieves your tension. Two, it gives you physical fitness. The more you are fit, the better you perform in the organization. Please be aware of those things. It's not that you have to be a sportsman and a long distance 10-kilometer runner. It could be anything. But physical activity to keep yourself day-to-day fit, coming to the office 5 days a week, taking leaves without telling the boss, is where the difference happens. These are the qualities that we look for. Now, why I started the whole thing with these skills and qualities, it's because when you go into the future, and as my previous speaker also spoke about, he gave you a horizon of what? 2 to 4 years of India, right? That's what he spoke about. He gave you what the challenges the environment has, what the challenges the marketing MD has, what are the kind of growth the India is looking for, what are the opportunities. I'm going to go a little beyond. What are the skills that you can learn or should learn if you want to survive for the next 30 years? That's what I'm going to talk about. Because this is important, because the skills that I spoke about, in terms of personal, in terms of how to handle yourself, keeping yourself physically fit, is one aspect of it. What are the opportunities that are coming in the future, and how do you also learn and develop your skills around those opportunities which are in the future? And it may not just be management opportunities, it may not just be a project opportunities, it also could be technical. Many of you are from IT sector. IT is the biggest area that is growing. But apart from that, there are various other things that are growing in the market. How do you train yourself to not just look at the horizon for the next 3 years, but beyond? I know for a fact that when you record for the job, when people come to interview you, what is your first priority? Get a job, get out of here. Right? You have taken a loan, you have some parents' commitments, you have some personal commitments. All that you are looking for is a job. Fine, you get a job. But what do you make out of that job? You are not going to be in that job for the whole life. Some of you may be, but not all of you. Even within the same job that you take, or if you want to change yourself into a new job, how do you train yourself to advance that same job? Or what are you looking out for in the future is where I am talking about. Those are the areas I will be touching upon. And how do you then merge those areas into the skills that you need to acquire? Right? So these are the areas I am talking about in terms of what's happening in the future, what's developing, what are the kind of different things that are coming in the environment, and how then you need to pursue some of this stuff, saying, I will expertise in this to develop in 20 years here. I want to go into this, learn these things, and develop into this. That's the roadmap I'm trying to share with you. Make sense?
Yes.
Everybody in sync?
Yes, sir.
Did I talk too much in the air?
No, sir.
Thank you. What is this? Any car?
Sedan car.
Very good. It's a driverless car. So why did I get a driverless car? It's the future. Battery operated, completely driverless, driven by a robot. So what's happening? Robots are taking over everything. Whether it is industries, manufacturing, cars, automation, even a call you make to the call center for your mobile not working is now going to be answered by a robot. So, robot is taking over everything. Automation is the area that is going leaps and bounds. Now, automation is not just in terms of manufacturing. Automation is not just in terms of a robot. Automation is not somebody talking to you. Automation is in various different areas. For example, in the IT sector, or in, let me give an example of banking. In the banking sector, when you call, right, for a credit card, how do I know that you are a genuine customer? I'll ask you some details. But how at the same time I can figure out what's your pattern of spend, what you're doing on the social networking, how do I take all those trends in the split of those few seconds that you're talking to me, try and see, are you a genuine customer, are you looking for a product, or are you a fraud? So I have three different areas. What's your problem? What can I sell to you? And are you a fraud? Now, how does a human sitting there handle these three things at the same time? Possible?
No.
Right? Can I enter in those split seconds, go to the internet, look at your LinkedIn profile, go to Facebook, see what are you posting, go and see your various other profiles and figure out, are you genuine, what are you looking for, what are the spending patterns you have done? Not possible. And that's where automation comes in. Robots are going to be so fast that they will in the future be able to predict each of these different scenarios, throw a pop up to the audit guy saying this is a fraud, or throw up to the marketing guy saying sell him this piece because he's looking for this particular piece of information. Or cross-sell him saying he's looking for a loan, you can sell him at this kind of interest rate. So those are the kinds of things that robots are doing. I'll give you an example. AlphaGo is a robot that was programmed to run a game. So you all know chess? A Go is a game which is like a chess in 8x8, Go is 19x19. Imagine the complexity, 19x19. And this computer was programmed, how was it programmed? It was fed all the past Go matches. Then one Go, AlphaGo was made to play with another AlphaGo to each other, so that they could learn. And then finally, the final one went and did a match with the highest dan, they call 9th dan, in the world in Go. And out of 5 games, he beat him in 4 games. So this is what? Programming. How do you train yourself to get into that programming down the line? What are the kind of opportunities you will have to look at in the IT sector to be in that kind of a line? That's what I want you to think about. In less than 30 years, you'll have biometric. All our hands, arms could be reprogrammed to run faster. Internal organs will be changed, right? So, medicine is an example. Your GoBit, Fitbits, they're looking at your heart rate, things like that. How do they use that data to sell you? Now, there is a company, for example, I'll give another example. What they do today, and you can imagine what they do in the future. So, this company is an insurance company. What they have done is they have tied up with a Fitbit kind of a or Samsung or something, they have given each of them that band. And now they are monitoring them. They are not just monitoring them, they are also putting few of the people together. So, 10 people in an area come together, form a group. And now they are motivating them. If you run 10,000 steps a day for 3 days, I will give you 2 cups of coffee in whatever CCD. If you get 2 others to do it, you get 4 cups of coffee. So, what happens? As a participant, you are motivated, you want that incentive, coffee or whatever may be the case. And as a company, people are fitter, less of them go to the hospital, less bills for them. So in a small investment, you can look at the data that can be used in a different way. Analytics being used in a different way. So how you can be in that area where you are thinking of these analytics, cross uses, and trying to reuse that data for a different thing. Sorry, you may not be able to see a little bit of this, so I'll just summarize this. This is a LinkedIn skills matrix. You can find it in the internet, so there's nothing that I have made it up. It shows a global skill matrix and it shows an India skill matrix. 70% of the skills are in the IT area. So whether it is like as analytics, big data, robotics, whatever, programming, but there are very niche areas also, not just about the IT. Whether it is So, I'll take an example. When you talk of skills, who's going to find that skill? HR. Who's going to train on that skill? Some teachers or some trainers, right? So, you need those kinds of skills to be there. HR will be required to recruit those guys. Trainers will be required to train those guys, right? That's the kind of vertical I'm talking about. So, IT is one, HR, economics, banking. There are different verticals that you could look at. Don't just look at IT as one vertical. Don't just look at the top IT teams and I want to go into Google or Amazon. It may happen, but it may not happen. You have to find other verticals where you can specialize and you can use your skills. In the next few years, job opportunities are changing. Whether it is banking, growth, management, a big growth, computers, architecture, sales. But these are only smaller pieces. The bigger piece is, I'll take an example right there, so legal has declined, I'm saying it will be bigger. Why? Cross-border remittance. cross-border skills. You're trying to sell from an Amazon India to somebody in the US. What kind of legal issues are you looking at? When I pay in dollars, what kind of US legal in issues am I going to face here? Who's going to resolve this? Legal teams. Right? So there are various other pieces that you have to start looking at, not just in terms of IT or HR or anything else. Another big area. Mobile. Gaming. Graphic designing. Interface of the mobile. What kinds of games are there? Right? How many of you played Pokemon? Very few. Surprising. I just thought half of you would have played it. How many have heard Pokemon? Very good. So, it's a very simple game. It's a very old game. But look at the way they have redesigned it, putting it on the maps and trying to make it interactive. How do you make an interactive UI? User interface. UX is user interface and user experience. UI is user interface, UX is user experience. How do you evolve that user experience? How do you develop yourself to get into that? And you know, you're not an IT guy, right? A user experience can be just a designer. You could be good at drawing. You could still get into that area. Using your IT or whatever background you are is only an advantage for you. So how do you skill yourself up into that area when you are getting into that graphics, you are getting into that user interface, getting into that programming, getting into just ideating about the game? This is going to be a big thing tomorrow. Leave everything else. How do you use mobile as a device to front-end better in your business? So you, whether it is a telecom vertical, whether it is a banking vertical, there, everybody wants to use a better interface to give a better experience to the customer. How are you getting into that? Workspace. So what is workspace? Where you are going to work. 20 years hence, how will that look like? Will it be a PC in the same workstation that you are looking at today? You think?
No.
So how do you get into that area of how the whole situation in the office will change? Leave that apart. In India, we are talking smart cities. How is the city going to be designed? You can imagine the kind of administration. So administrative people are in the administration field, people are in the program management. What kind of your area is expertise you can gain to participate in projects like this? Whether it is a workspace change, whether it is a smart city change, what kind of areas you can grow yourself into? If you see, this diagram is a little small, but what is also shown is that the office is no longer going to be one place. It will be mobile, it will be my home office, it could be anywhere. I could just walk up into a mall and that offices are, it's an open office. I just sit anywhere, use that for 1 hour, pay for it in my back end, and it's done. So those kinds of things, you have to start imagining things, how you can design those. Energy. With the computer growing, energy is growing like rapidly. And what are the energy of the future? Oil? Solar. So how do you get into solar business? What are the kinds of challenges that they are there? How do you increase the solar energy output for India? Right? The government is looking at those kind of things. How do you get into those areas with the project management, with the systems? Agriculture, nanofoods. Again, a very different area. And it's not just about automation. It's also about how you implement, whether it is tractor, whether it is the way things will be there. Will farming exist in 20 years? You don't know. It will be laboratories. News and entertainment content. So, YouTube. Classic example. Somebody publishes a video, huge amount of ads, people get money out of it. How do you, so I was speaking about extracurricular. You could be a dancer, publish a video on the YouTube and if it has 100 million hits, you are a different person tomorrow. So how do you get into that content where tomorrow you are using a different kind of skill from what you have learned today for a different kind of purpose in the end? Right? News bulletins. They are going to be completely different from what they are today. Half of them have gone online. You are streaming them on the TV at home. No, not using it through the cable anymore. I am doing it through the internet. I don't have cable connection at home for almost 6 years. Half my internet comes from the internet. Right? So that is a completely changing world. How do you develop yourself to get into that area where you are developing that content and making yourself rich? Look at it as another thing. If you want to become an entrepreneur, if you want to do a startup, what kind of areas can you look at in these? Whether it is a vertical news, vertical in YouTube, vertical in publishing something, a game coming up, or a mobile application, which will change the world. How did you do it in Alakama? Ideas. It's just a mobile app, nothing else, right? It's a platform. People have made millions out of Uber and Ola, right? So if you want to become an entrepreneur, if you want to go into startups, you have to come into an idea, come into a platform and use that to leverage yourself. International laws, I touched upon this earlier, compliance, international law, there are going to be big things. Tomorrow if you go into an Uber and Ola, you will have to start looking at these kinds of areas. Who will do the compliance? How will it going to be implemented? What kind of laws does the US apply? What kind of laws the UK applies to me? Those things you can learn into those areas as well. So develop your skills in those areas. Learn about it. Again, I have touched upon the little bit of skills here. So in the end, what I want to talk about is the fact that the skills that whether Professor Velluri spoke about in the morning, or Rajiv Mitra spoke about, or I touched upon, are some of the basic platforms you have to touch about. Whether it is personal motivation, whether it is the skill to speak, whether it is performing in a team, whether it is growing yourself, or whether it is the technical skills that I spoke about in the entire slides. Various, I give various different examples. How do you collect all those to grow yourself, make yourself suitable for a job that you're looking for tomorrow, or make sure that you're growing yourself in the next 10 to 15 years? It's not just the skill that you acquire today in the whole of, right? It's going to continue with you. So you have to keep that in mind that the skills of the future are something you have to build slowly, will take you time, but some of the basic platforms that your teachers are talking to you about are very important and critical even now. Again, I have put up some examples of different senses that are required today, responsibility, information gathering, taking responsibility, finding humor, thinking independently. So these are some of the critical things that we look out for in a person. You as new freshers coming out from your institutes need to be aware of some of these things. People judge you for that, people take you for that. Right? So when you come across, you only have 10 minutes, you either a GD or whatever. But how do you portray what is your underlying foundation? What is it that you are made of? That's the only time that you have. You have to make sure that you are honing those skills time and again, making sure you are coming across as what you are, not artificial, because someone will fall over. If you get a job, probably you will be thrown out if you are not in that mode. I have seen people come in and not being able to sustain the pressure in the organization, not being able to gel into teams, not being able to perform. It's going to be very critical that you go into a right organization rather than going into something you are going to be sick of in a 2 months' time. Right? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now the house is open for questions.
I am happy to take any questions, by the way. So don't limit it to my presentation only. Anything you want to ask? I'm okay to
answer in a second. Sir, my name is Nikita. I'm from PIDN. Sir, so you talked about the jobless.
Hello. So you talked about driverless cars, or in 2030, the human position, that the work will be replaced by robots. So, sir, so my question is, in which area we of the new generation have to focus for job to generate income? Like, what's your take on job creation?
Correct. In the few years, while robots will replace some of the critical low-lying areas, can they replace everything? No. Your human thinking, your human mind, your human innovation still comes into play. Right? That is where I touched upon. For example, I gave you the example of interface of new application. User interface of game. Those are areas that the robot can may not replace, right? That the human has to perform. So that is where I say, how do you develop your expertise in some of these critical areas which a robot will never replace, right? Programming the driverless car, it's itself going to take some human. So the thought process has to come from the human. So that is where you have to develop your skills in that area which will continue. Yes, a call center call being taken and all these things, analysis being done, a robot can do. But behind, how do you keep yourself to look at that area? Now, in terms of job application also, which you said, developing that application somebody has to do. Coming up with that idea, somebody still has to do. Right? The robot is not going to come up with an idea. So that's where you have to apply yourself.
Krishna from BMHRD Marketing. So my question is, keeping the advantages aside, so what would be the challenges for the companies which go for mergers and acquisition in future?
More and more, as I said, laws, international laws, are going to be more critical. What am I defaulting on? Who am I taking over? What is their strengths? What is the kind of synergies between the two organizations? Those are kind of challenges which we have. Another big area that is even a challenge today and will always continue, two different organizations not only have different cultures, IT systems are different. How do you merge them? It becomes a challenge. So across industries, when different, any company merges, the challenges are various. How to overcome them one by one is going to be in terms of how, what advantage you see at the end, it is going to decide how the whole thing comes out.
Good morning, sir.
Hello, sir.
Upstairs on your right.
Okay.
Good morning, sir. My name is Reva. So with respect to all the technological advances that are taking place and the skills that we have to imbibe in ourselves to survive in the future, what do you think is the essence of a formal education like this?
Honestly speaking, formal education could also be self-taught. Can. But in the end, an environment like this, taking a Balaji Institute by itself, the kind of interface you have here with other people, the kind of learnings you have with people like us coming to talk to you about, the kind of learning you have by teachers giving you that is something which cannot replace very easily. Right? The formal education is definitely required. But as I said, how much percentage did I give the formal education? In the end of the cycle, only 10%. Right? Why? Because the other piece is very critical as to how you have evolved yourself by the in ecosystem around you. How did you interact with your peers? How did you form, go into a team and what did you share? What did you give back to the team? That's more critical. How as an individual you are doing, whether it's sports or other active curricular activities, they play an important part. And that is part of the formal education system, which can't be done away. So education in itself can be self-taught. The academics around the other ecosystem cannot be replaced.
Hello. Good morning, sir. Sir, I'm from Telecom Best. Sir, you talked about academics that it is not matter so much. We give 10% weightage to that. But there are a large number of companies who give weightage to those. You will not able to seek for GD or PI if you don't have such criteria. There are many number of students who have this type of problem. So how we can overcome that? If we are having some problem in academics in some 10% or some.
Okay. See, the point is, how much of a problem you have gone through decides that. If you have 10th or 12th had that kind of a big problem, you are not first of all not compared with the first place. The fact that you reach there, that means you have a basic minimum criteria. Going ahead, what I meant is the passing percentage as a base is fine. You may not be as eighth grader. But adding clear everything probably is what matters to you, because now you should not have time to say, okay, I need 6 months to clear my remaining papers. That's one criteria. But the more criteria, as I said, academics probably contributes to the fact that it is building your base. Like I was answering the other person also. It gives you a base. So, yes, various companies do give a little more criteria to academics. But in the end, is that what you're planning out from this college? No. It is also the environment. It's how, what you have taught yourself. It's what your base you have built for yourself. It's what you're planning out. In the long run, in 2 years' time, when you go for the next job, or when you go for an internal transfer, when anybody asks you what did you learn in biology, nobody will ask you. What they will ask you, what did you learn in your current job? And what you took from here is only going to be a platform for that job, that first job that you're doing. So yes, it matters, but not that much.
Yeah, but sir, means in the starting phase, we need to have such things. Means, suppose for the placement, if I give the example, there are multiple companies who come for a criteria. So we are not able to seek for those. Means, so what we should do in this phase? After a particular experience or so, we can do something. But for this particular place, what should we do?
I don't think, and probably our professors may be able to guide you, I don't think every company will come and say, I need a 10th grader. They are not 9th grader, all of them are not 9th graders, so they are not everybody, right?
So yes, for some of the few companies will take it up, but there are other companies who will come and give bigger opportunities. Startup, for example, they will not look at now 900 only. Right? So they will give you, and the exposure you might get in a startup, maybe at a lower grade, could be completely different from what you will get in an MNC. So there are opportunities.
And so one more thing. Sir, suppose if you are having some problem in academy, so is there anything extracurricular activity or something which can overcome that or which can solve
the 100% nothing can, definitely not. And your professor will also tell you, 100% nothing can change over. Unless you are saying I want to become into sports completely and leave the academics, which is not going to be the case.
Hello, sir. This will be the last question.
Yeah, 1 minute,
I'll answer to them. Good morning, sir. As we have seen that the technologies are getting more in the urban areas than in the rural areas, so do you think it, in the future there will be a gap between the people from urban area and rural area? Because, for example, in rural areas, you can in urban areas, you can see that people use voice technology. Like they say, okay, Google or hey Siri. But in rural areas, it's not that much used because even the technology or the government is not giving that much visibility in the rural areas. So do you think the society will be distinguished in few sections?
It is great. I think that the technology itself is going to narrow that distinction. There are more and more people coming out with mobiles which are able to give you multilingual capability. I'm sure that down the line there will be similar applications which will come in native languages. They will understand Tamil or Telugu or Marathi and Gujarati. They will come. It is how the demand happens. 1.2 billion people, if they start demanding for language Siri, it will come in somebody. Some startup will come and make it. So I don't think that's a big thing. How much of a penetration that guy in the rural market is able to afford that phone or get the internet connection in the first place, where this will decide. So whether Jio makes a difference or whether the telecom revolution that Modi wants to bring will make technology available is going to be the bigger challenge. Rather than the fact that the application is not available or not, they will become available. Very soon, in 2-3 years, we will see that change. So your last question.
Hello sir. My name is Devan Rajur from IMB Finance. My question to you is with some fact that various banks, including Deutsche, across India wants to join hands with the postal departments in order to expand their banking facilities. Also, it is said that 650 new postal offices are to be created. Now the question comes, what does government expect from the banking sector, that government expects you to invest in the 650 postal offices? Or my question is, put some, throw some light on this.
Okay. The idea behind the whole process is to increase the reach. The question that he asked, will technology be available to the rural masses? This is the initiative where they are trying to make a banking, a street post and all these kinds of other processes go into the rural, and what they see is the post office is available in every district. Can that be leveraged to make that technology reach those end rural guys? The new creation of new post office is going to be funded by the fact that I as a bank am going to use them. If I go there and make 20,000 customers, I'm going to give money to the post office. Post office will use that to create new branches. So the opportunity for the banks and for the government is to merge together in terms of this initiative, use this to reach the rural areas and the post office on in the area.
Along with that, is banking sector going to appoint employees to work in the rural areas with postal departments? May or may not.
I could train the postal employees as well. I could give them a tablet to do everything that I want. How do you use technology to try and eliminate that need for somebody? Even if I have to appoint, maybe I will appoint if there is sufficient account coming in through or the revenue coming in through. So it depends on how each individual post office comes up. Okay, thank you very much. Thanks everybody for having me.
Thank you, sir. The meeting is aware of the upcoming trends in employment, which are expected in the near future. You also gave us an insight on how big data works, how user interface and user experience change the market scenario, how artificial intelligence would take over.
We've got an idea of how the dynamic changes that would occur in the field of workspace, energy, news, and entertainment. It was indeed a learning experience. We look forward to many such interactions on and off the campus.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Professor Kalam, Director, Projects and Alumni Affairs, to present memento to Mr. Rajiv Girela.